Zion, on behalf of the congregation, a special welcome to our guests, friends, neighbors, family. Know that your presence enriches this community in so many ways, and we are so glad that you are here, whether by Zoom or by Facebook or by watching the video later. We're glad that you are with us. This Sunday in worship, we celebrate the baptism of Bryce James Pryor, and we get to receive as new members the Pryor and Weiss family. Welcome to this lovely family. We'll get to watch the video in just a little bit. But for others, if you are interested in baptism or membership, please let us know. We sort of took a little bit of a pause as the pandemic hit, but if this is something that you would like to explore, please be in touch. For today's worship, you will need a few things. You will need a candle to light at the beginning of the service, as well as bread and wine or crackers and juice, as we will celebrate communion together. And then note that you are invited throughout the screen to put prayer requests in the chat box on the side of the screen. And as we come to the prayers of the people, we will include those prayers. A preview about this morning's gospel. In today's gospel, Jesus tells the story of a landowner who hires workers throughout the day, then choosing to pay them all the same. Such generosity makes the workers furious. So our question today is, how might we respond to God's generosity? I invite you at the beginning of this worship service to take a moment for prayer. There are two ways that you might pray this morning. One is a breath prayer, which is just to take several deep breaths, recognizing that God is near you and beside you. And the second is a word prayer, which is to take several deep breaths and repeat this phrase, which comes from this morning's gospel, because I am generous. So take a moment or two to do a breath prayer or a word prayer, and then we will light our candle and begin. Our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness, we invite you to sing out at home.
Mercies I see, all I have need.
come to the holy baptism of Bryce James Pryor, which we did on Friday in the lawn by Zion. This is a lovely day and a lovely moment, and one of the first cool days we had, which meant that the sound is a little rough because we had a nice breeze going. So I invite you to turn up the sound on your computer as loud as it goes and lean in just a little bit and enjoy this baptism.
Mercy and love gives us new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined in God's mission for the life of the world. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your daughters and sons new birth. Cleanse them from sin and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Christ with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Christ, with some oil on your forehead. Christ, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit.
So the trade-off for a lovely cool day was a little bit of wind. So let's see if I think the prior family is on. So Laura, if you might be willing to show your camera, and we're going to spotlight you as the congregation offers a welcome to Bryce. Let me make sure y'all are still there. You are. All right. Let us welcome the newly baptized.
We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Let us, in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world.
Amen. So hopefully after the service, priors, if you and Weisses, if you would like to stay on for a little bit, I know the congregation would love to get to know you just a little bit. Usually we have a new member reception and other things that accompany our baptism. So maybe if you'll just stay on for a bit, we can get to know you. We continue with our greeting. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you show perpetual loving kindness to us, your servants. Because we cannot rely on our own abilities, grant us your merciful judgment and train us to embody the generosity of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We continue with the readings.
The first reading this morning is from Jonah 3. When God saw what the people of Nineveh did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, it is right for you to be angry. Then Jonah went out of the city and set east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush, but when dawn came upon the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And he said, yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, you are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in the night and perished in the night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm this morning is Psalm 145. I will exalt you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever.
Every day will I bless you and praise your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. There is no end to your greatness.
One generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your power.
I will speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty and all your marvelous works.
They shall tell of the might of your wondrous acts, and I will recount your greatness.
They shall punish the remembrance of your great goodness. They shall sing joyfully of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
The second reading this morning is from Philippians 1. For to me, living is Christ and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to the last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last.' The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O God, our rock and redeemer. Amen. A few years ago, a friend of mine invited me to join him for something called Tacos on 21. Highway 21 is a highway that runs through the north of Bryan, Texas, and just off a little gas station on 21 is the neighborhood where migrant workers wait for work each morning. I shrugged and invited a few college students to come with me, and we got up early the next day to make breakfast tacos for all of the workers waiting for work that morning. I don't remember much about that morning. We were up before 6 a.m., but I do remember that as we walked this quiet neighborhood in North Bryan, handing out juice and tacos, my friend knew the name of every man waiting for work. The next week, my students and I went back, and the next, and soon we took over the ministry, and we too came to know the names of the men out on Highway 21. And then their stories, where they were from. And then we came to learn about their families and the children they had left behind because there was no work and no food. For the next 8 years, I walked those streets with students a few times a month. As the men came to recognize us, we also came to know things about their world, like the code. When a truck comes by looking for workers, and it was always a truck, we came to see which men would get picked first: younger, stronger, better English, and which men would likely spend most of the day waiting outside: older, slower, less English. And while the younger ones would get picked more often, the older ones knew more. They knew things about the trucks. They knew which employers would promise to pay you but then would not. They knew which employers were kind and would look out for you. They knew which ones to avoid at all costs. The trucks, you see, had reputations. Which helps me to understand our text this morning. Or more accurately, it helps me understand how completely ridiculous our text is this morning. Here's the story in a nutshell. A landowner goes out to hire workers, a big truck. At the beginning of the day, he hires his first shift and promises them a day's wage. He's fair and has a good reputation. At noon and nine, he hires more, then at three, then at five. When pay time rolls around, he calls for the ones who were hired last. They had worked 1 hour that day. These were probably older and slower, less likely to get picked, seen as less valuable. Here's a full day's pay, he tells them. They go on their way, eyes wide. What a day! Perhaps they were gleeful as they walked home to tell their families the good news, to buy bread along the way. But can you imagine the silence among the rest of the workers? What? The rest start to whisper. Did we mishear? By then he has called for the next set of workers, the 3 o'clock workers, those who had worked for 3 hours. A full day's pay, he tells them, and slaps their payment in their hand. They go on their way, also stunned, also gleeful. The day had started so poorly. They had waited so long. A full day's pay? What a gift. But by now, frowns start to disappear. Is he going to pay us double? The early workers start to whisper. He sure is generous today. These might have been the youngest and the strongest, those used to being picked first, used to working all day. But when it's their turn, the ones who had worked a full day, he hands them the same amount. But we worked a full day, they remind him. Yes, and that's what I'm paying you for, a full day. But they didn't work a full day. That's not fair. Well, what business is it of yours? Are you envious because I am generous? And that is the story, the scandalous story that we are given. It doesn't make sense, does it? Certainly not from an economic perspective. Landowners were interested in profit, not kindness. They were interested in work, not popularity, sales, not reputation. This, after all, was the marketplace. The goal was to earn a living, not give it away to everyone else. And while we can get caught up in the economics of the story, or rather the ridiculousness of the economics, that's not what this story is about. This is a story about a landowner. It's about a landowner who kept going back to the marketplace over and over because the landowner just couldn't stay away. Could you imagine this happening? I certainly couldn't, not on the streets of Bryan. A truck circling all day, making sure every last worker was picked up, and not only picked up, but paid fairly, and not only paid fairly, but paid generously. That's a truck that would have gotten a reputation. But that reputation is who God is. God is so persistent, so loving, so gracious, that God keeps on coming, circling the truck around the neighborhood one more time, one more time, one more time, to invite us again and again to receive the incredible grace of God. Through bread and wine, through remembering your baptism, through the people gathered here even by Zoom, through the hope of new members, through the love of community, through the joy and laughter of coffee hour, through your heart for service. All those things, those are God's invitation to you, even you, even you 5 o'clock workers who no longer feel useful or seen, or who feel anxious or tired, or who feel sad and overwhelmed, or who feel lonely and nervous, or who are rattled by grief or a diagnosis. Even you, wherever you are this morning, God is swinging through one more time to invite you to the feast, to cast your cares on God, to allow yourself to be loved and held by the God who created you. God is always inviting us to deeper grace. What a miracle. This morning, we witnessed the baptism of Bryce James Pryor. What a joyous occasion. How fun to see Bryce's surprised expression at the coolness of the water, his curiosity about the oil, the way he studied everything around him. How incredible to see family and godparents gathered around on a gorgeous, cool morning to make promises for Bryce, to speak words of love and belonging. What a gift to Bryce, and what a gift to Zion. But here's the thing, baptism won't be the only time that God swings through the neighborhood of Bryce's life. Because what happens in baptism is that God doesn't just swing through, but nudges open the door and pats the passenger seat and invites us to buckle up and stay close. Baptism reminds us that we sit snug against the landowner who just can't stay away. What an incredible God we serve. One morning when I was out walking with students through the streets of Bryan, tacos and juice in hand, we fell into conversation with one of the regular men. "What makes this life bearable?" one of our students asked him. "Being so far from home, not knowing what your day will bring, not seeing your children grow up, what makes this life bearable?" "You do," he responded, pointing to our group. "You come out here. You know our names. You see us. You are the only ones who see us. You make this life bearable." The joy of life in Christ means that we are invited to see the world differently, through the eyes of God, through the eyes of the landowner, through the eyes of the one so easily moved by compassion that staying away is impossible. Kindness is inevitable, even when it doesn't make good economic sense. God is swinging through the neighborhood, inviting you to the vineyard, inviting you to the feast of love. Come and taste the goodness of God, and then go and be the goodness of God. For the workers are waiting, and the world is so hungry. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Like we are having a little bit of a technical difficulty. We will continue with our welcoming of new members. Dear friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism and for Laura and Blake Pryor and Peggy Weiss, one with us in the body of Christ, whom we welcome as new members into the life and ministry of this congregation. Laura and Blake Pryor and Peggy Weiss have come to our congregation from Hope Lutheran in San Antonio. Earlier this week, I got to sit down and chat with them, and I asked them to just do a little bit of an introduction for the congregation. So we have this little video so you can get to know them a little bit.
Well, good morning. We are so thrilled to be able to welcome to Zion Peggy Jo Weiss, Laura and Blake Pryor, and their son Bryce. Welcome, you guys. We are so excited to welcome you and to get to know you. We just had a few questions that I wanted to ask you so the congregation could get to know you a little bit better. First, tell us who you are.
So I am Laura Beth Pryor. This is Bryce James Pryor, and this is my husband, Blake Pryor. We've been married about 6 years now, and we had Bryce 10 months ago. We met in Houston and lived here for about a year, and then moved to Africa and lived in Angola for about 4 years for my husband's job, and moved back to Houston about a year and a half ago. My mom and I, this is Peggy and my mom, and we are members in San Antonio at Hope Lutheran. And since we've had Bryce and moved back to Houston, we wanted to transfer our memberships and then find a new home. We visited Zion in February and met a number of the members. And so that's who we are.
And I'm Peggy, and I have worked at USAA in San Antonio. That's a insurance company for the military, for those who are unfamiliar, for 43 years, and my husband has also. And we both are retired now. He'll be going on 6 years, and I'll be going on, I believe, four. So we love coming up to Houston and visit our grandson and my daughter and Blake. So I'm looking forward to joining in Zion.
So you mentioned that when you started looking around, you had looked at some other churches and you decided on Zion. I wondered if you might tell the congregation a little bit about why.
Sure, yeah. So I was really involved with my church growing up and did a lot of youth camps, and that's where I did confirmation and communion. And when we first came to Zion in February, everybody was so friendly, and it really felt exactly like how kind of my church was back home, where everybody knew each other. And when somebody was new, everybody wanted to welcome them. And so that was really just the feeling that I want to kind of have give my son, and hopefully he meets some good friends too that are about his age, because I've heard there's a baby boom happening at Zion. So we're looking forward to joining and then having Bryce get involved.
Okay, so my last question for y'all is, as you think about what you hunger for in a faith life, tell us a little bit about that. What do you long for? What do you hunger for in a church?
Well, I think as Laura said, part of it's definitely the community, right? The people around you and how comfortable you feel. So that's a huge part of it. So I know when Miss Peggy and Laura went and visited Zion, they got the feeling of the community that they wanted to be part of. And so that's definitely part of it. But raising Bryce with the right, you know, moral and right tone to his life. Also always meeting new people, I think, is really important that are wanting to raise their children with the same ideas and principles and things like that. So we're looking forward to getting involved, seeing some of the youth activities when he gets a little older. As you can tell, he's a very active child. but also getting involved with some volunteering opportunities, you know, seeing everybody on Sundays, things like that. So no, we're looking forward to being part of the community.
Well, great. Well, welcome to Zion. We're so thrilled to have you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we come to our official welcome. And so Prior Weiss family, if you are again willing to turn on your camera, and there is a line for you all to speak, and we will spotlight you. Let me see, let me turn mine on. There we go. Michael, if you will unmute them, they are on the screen as Prior/Weiss family. Ah, we hear him. There we go. And if you will go ahead and spotlight them, Michael. There we go. Now we can see them. We love the energy and the noise of babies. It's just such a gift to a congregation to hear these happy noises. In baptism, we are welcomed into the body of Christ and sent to share in the mission of God. We are called to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Sisters and brothers in Christ, do you intend to continue in the covenant of your baptism among God's people in this place? And you are invited to respond, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
And this is a question for the congregation. People of God, do you promise to support and pray for these new members in their life in Christ?
We do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
Let us welcome these sisters and brothers in Christ to this community of faith.
We rejoice with you in the life of baptism.
Together we will give thanks
and praise
to God, proclaim
the good news to all the world.
Welcome to Zion.
Welcome to Zion. When I was talking with the family earlier this week, I love something that Laura told me. She said that when she visited back in February, folks were so friendly after the service that she thinks she spent more time chatting after the service than she did actually inside the service, which is great. We are really thrilled to welcome you. We continue with our prayers. And just a reminder that you can put prayers in the chat box during this time, and we will pray for them near the end of our prayers. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need.
Graciously hear our prayer.
We give you thanks for the newly baptized Bryce and for our new members, Laura, Blake, and Peggy, whom you have drawn to yourself by the love of Jesus Christ, and whom we have welcomed into this household of faith. Keep us close together in your spirit, in the breaking of bread and the prayers, and in service to others. O God, you are full of compassion. Graciously hear our prayer. Continue your care for your whole creation, sun and wind, bushes and worms, cities and farms, and all your many animals. We pray for firefighters and for communities devastated by fire, for hurricane victims and communities facing storms. We pray for the mending of all creation. O God, you are full of compassion.
Graciously hear our prayer.
In places of conflict and violence, bring peace, especially to the cities of our nation. Bless the work of negotiators, peacekeepers, and development workers. Preserve protesters and guide police. Enlighten our nation and all nations around the world. O God, you are full of compassion.
Graciously hear our prayer.
Give your blessing to the Jewish people at this time of their new year. Deepen our interfaith relationships. Bring an end to anti-Semitism around the globe and strengthen peace efforts in the Middle East.
O God, you are full of compassion.
Graciously hear our prayer.
To all who are suffering, show your mercy. For all who suffer racial injustice, for migrants who seek safety, for all who are imprisoned, for victims of crime, for the unemployed, for students and faculty during the pandemic, for children and parents, for medical workers, for those suffering from the coronavirus, and for all who are hungry. We especially pray for Doris, Virginia, Kathy, Ellie, Jean, Harold, Priscilla, Nora, Dolores, Harvey, Barbara, and Diane. O God, you are full of compassion.
Graciously,
hear our prayer. We pray for the prayers listed in our chat box. We pray for Slider at the loss of his beloved pet, Lucy. For families affected by Hurricane Sally and are anxious about the upcoming storms, especially our friends, the Yule family. For the healing of Bobby and strength and calmness for Jeanette. For peace for Shyla and Chris. For raising up our recognizing pride without shame or contempt in all people's identity. For Pastor Richard from Sharon's church. O God, you are full of compassion.
Graciously hear our prayer.
All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
We continue with our offering. You are invited to give in one of three ways at Zion. One is by check to the church office. The address is on the screen. Another is by the Tithely mobile app, which is easy to download on your phone. And the third way is through our website. And just to note that we continue our benevolence for Luther Hill for the month of September. If you get the weekly announcements, you'll see that we are looking at a Zion Day at Luther Hill in November. Luther Hill is doing all sorts of distancing and has great safety precautions in place for the fall. And we are looking at going together, but separately in our cars, to Luther Hill for a day of camp. So watch for more information about that. We continue with the meal. You are invited to gather bread or crackers and wine or juice for communion. And just a note about how we do communion at Zion. You are very welcome to receive, regardless of if you're a member of another church or if you're not quite sure of all this stuff. Whoever you are, know that we trust that Christ is the host at this meal and Jesus welcomes you. We continue with our offering prayer.
Let us pray.
Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. You have set before us these gifts of your good creation. Prepare us for your heavenly banquet. Nourish us with this rich food and drink, and send us forth to set tables in the midst of a suffering world through the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
On earth as it is in heaven.
Give us
this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our trespasses.
As we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us
from evil. For thine kingdom
and the power and the glory
forever and ever.
Amen.
Friends of Jesus, the table of joy is set before you. Receive nourishment for your journey. You're invited to receive the bread and wine with the words, the body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you.
Body of Christ given for you.
For those who do not receive and would like a blessing, receive this blessing. The God who loves you has drawn you close and will never let you go. Amen. For our table blessing, now that you have tasted the goodness of God in bread and wine, let us be the body of Christ, blessed and broken for the whole world. Amen.
Amen.
Continue with our final hymn.
How small the span of life for God, our years from birth till death, a single beat within the heart, a catching of a breath, a drop within the ocean's deep, a grain upon the shore, a flash of light before we sleep to see the sun no more. And yet our
to our announcements, and I have a few. If you also have an announcement, if you will sort of wave your hand or unmute yourself, and we will call on you in a sec. So a few that I had. This week is week two of our forgiveness study. We had a great study last week. We had quite a few of you come, and it was a really dynamic night with good conversation. If you missed the first week but want to join us, send me a note and I'll send you the materials. You could catch up with the material and join us on week two. You are very welcome. Second, we are looking at having a pet blessing on October 3rd. This is a Saturday at 5 o'clock. Jenny Poche is working on the logistics for this and putting it together. I think we will have a drive-through option and a socially distanced option as well. That'll be in 2 weeks, so get those pets ready. The next morning, I think we'll do a pet blessing for those pets who are less comfortable or those people who are less comfortable leaving their house. So you can also gather them during Zoom and we'll bless them then also. And then October 17th, we are looking at a return to in-person outdoor worship under our pavilion. Dory has been taking the lead with thinking about this, but it looks like it'll be a really great evening. We're going to try this for 4 weeks maybe and then see how it's working out. But plan on Saturday evenings. It won't be what we do on Sunday mornings. It'll be a different approach. More casual. You're welcome to bring your dinner or bring your favorite beverage or whatever you'd like and a blanket, and it'll be a nice evening. We're wanting this to be family friendly also, and so know that children are welcome too. Alice is working on some options for children during this time. So get excited about the return of in-person worship in mid-October. Let's see, next week in worship, also very exciting, we will commission two of our lay chaplains, Ken Fortner and John Boddy, who have gone through a good amount of training to be commissioned as chaplains. So this will be an important part of our worship service. Congratulations to them. And then also just wanted to offer another welcome to the Pryor and the Weiss families and to tell you how thrilled we are to get to know you. For those who are able to stay on for a little bit after after our sharing of the piece, if you have just want to get to know them a little bit, if they're able to stay on, and if you have some questions about who they are and they have questions about who we are, it'll be a great time to answer that. So plan on staying on for a few more minutes if possible so you can get to know them. And also, if you are newer to Zion and interested in either membership or baptism, send me a note. We can be creative about these things. And the pandemic doesn't stop the work of the church, so send me a note. Is there anyone else who has an announcement? I am looking around. You will need to unmute yourself and you can jump right in. No, I don't think so. We'll continue with our blessing then. The God of compassion, hope, and joy, our creator, redeemer, and sustainer, bless your feet to carry you into places of need. Bless your lips to proclaim love and mercy. Bless your heart to love and listen to those you encounter. Bless your hands to care for the needs of your neighbors. Bless you to be a blessing to others, now and always. Amen. Amen.
Go in peace, remembering the poor.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
And we will.
Please share the peace with one another.
Peace. 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 Peace.